Well, welcome to our service this morning. Whether you're online at home or somewhere else, or seated here this morning. Today is the fourth Sunday in Lent, and it's right in the middle of Lent. During medieval times and later, this Sunday was called Refreshment Sunday, because the initial discipline of Lent as it was practiced then was tempered with more the joy that we're actually walking in the presence of the one who gives joy. After our service this morning, there will be a congregational meeting, and following that, there will be a luncheon for everyone. People have been invited to bring a plate, but one thing I've learnt in many years of being members of congregations is that there is always enough food if you've come and you forgot to bring a plate or didn't know about it. My name is Dean Drayton, and the service is being led by the Reverend Dr. Clive Pearson. Our call to worship. The Lord is our shepherd. We shall not want. He makes us lie down in green pastures. He leads us beside still waters. He restores our soul. He leads us in right paths for his name's sake. And even though we walk through the darkest valley, we fear no evil. For you are with us, your rod and your staff, they comfort us. And so, Lord God, we worship you. It's time to sing. If you're able, would you like to stand and sing, "Rejoice in the Lord always"?
What's been happening with the music today? We're teaching you a new song now. It's a different "Rejoice in the Lord Now and Always", and we're going to teach it to you first. But before we do that, I want to introduce this team here who've worked very hard. I'm talking multiple midweek sessions in their own time. And so we've got Rod Schuster on the drums, David Porter on the guitar, Harry McWilliam on bass, Melanie and Juwan McWilliam. So I'd like you to sit back and listen to this first verse, and then we'll stand and sing it together.
What about Noel? Oh. No, I'm just part of the furniture.
I'm sorry, Noel's playing the oboe and singing. And you know me. Oh, and the other thing about today, it's a very guitar-oriented day. So we're having a piano-free session for a while. So I hope you enjoy the guitar feel to be different. And let's go, 1, 2.
Rejoice in the Lord now and always. Sing it again, we rejoice. Delight in the love he has shown us. Gratefully lift up your voice. His gentleness among us will join our hearts with praise. We gather in his goodness, a family of grace. With each breath he's given, in these times we live in, we will praise the Lord throughout every season. I am sure of every reason to praise the Lord.
Rejoice
So we come to our prayers of praise, thanksgiving, and forgiveness. Let us pray. We praise you, God, that you are with us, shining your light upon us, so that we may see you so clearly disclosed in our Lord Jesus Christ. Yours is the light of creation, a new creation, the light of new possibilities of your spirit in what is right and good and true. We praise you, Lord, for what we see as impossible situations. You see as the space and the place that your light shines. With the new, open to your kingdom presence. For you do not push us into the old ways, but you open new life, new directions, new surroundings for our future. We praise you that you are the God of new contexts, not the old, and that you bring in these your blessing and your peace. We thank you that you live near us, not far away. You make it possible for us to live as children of light, to please you and find fulfillment in life. We become aware of how quickly our life passes through our hands. The years passing by, and like the click of a finger, a decade is gone. But you call us not only to give thanks for the past, but to be grateful that you keep us open to your eternity, in your ways, in your future. We give thanks that the good and the bad is held together in your hands, for underlying all is your great purpose of renewing the creation, bringing heaven into the earth, changing time and place to be fit for your great dream of eternal life. Eternal God, we give you thanks that you keep on forgiving us as we keep on foisting our views upon you. You forgive us as we live by our deepest convictions rather than the gift of your presence. You forgive us as we defend our own self-important views. You forgive us as we dig ever deeper into ourselves. Forgive us for not giving space and place to your presence and the wonders that you perform in creation and human lives. Forgive us for our blindness to the kingdom of God, too confident in what we see, but blind to your light and grace showered upon us. But this day, we hear again that we are washed in the power and love of the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, where we see your face for us. This day, help us turn and see you more clearly, so that we may discover your peace and live in your presence. So we come to the words of assurance. The peace of Christ be with you. So now we move towards the art of faith. Okay. It's true.
Good morning, everyone. Can I invite all the kids to come out the front? Now, this morning, I've brought in a bit of a video for us to watch. Now, while we're watching this video, I want you to pay close attention. I want you to tell me at the end, and everyone can participate in this, how many times the white team passes the ball. So it's a bit of a basketball game. I want you to tell me how many times the white team passes the ball. All right, so when we're ready, we can play the video.
How many passes does the team in white make?
Go!
All right. Did anyone count how many times the white team passed the ball? 13. You'd be correct. It was 13. But I'm not focused on how many times the white team passed the ball. I'm wondering if anyone saw the moonwalking bear in the back of the video. Okay, We're going to rewind the video and watch it again. Let's have a look. Focus on the moonwalking bear.
How many passes does the team in white make?
Go!
Ask again, how many of you saw the moonwalking bear? Okay. This reminds me a bit of our reading for this morning. So in this morning's reading, we have a blind man. And Jesus heals this blind man. He heals him with a bit of mud and spit. It's a whole process. But after he's healed, what happens is that no one believes it. He goes to the Pharisees and tries to tell him about this amazing thing. And the Pharisees question him. They're like, how? How did this happen? And he keeps saying, Jesus, the Son of God, healed me. They go and ask his parents, and the same thing happens. Now, I think this story is not just about a man that was blind, but I think in some ways the Pharisees were a bit blind. They were blind to seeing Jesus. They weren't looking for what they wanted. They were looking exactly for what they wanted. Just like in our video, we were looking for the white players passing the ball. We weren't focused on what else was in the scene. It wasn't until we pointed out what was happening that we noticed. That's a reminder to us to not necessarily be like the Pharisees, not to have a frame on one thing, to focus on Jesus, to put our focus on Jesus and to look for the things of Jesus. If we have a mind focused on Jesus, we're more likely to see him. We're more likely to see the things that he does in our life, the things that he does for other people, things that he does around us. So I want you to think about this moonwalking bear and think about Jesus and what he might be doing in your life. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you so much that even though we might be focused on certain things, that you are still around us. You are still there for us. Pray that you will help us to open our eyes, to see you, to focus on you. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we're going to sing another song now before we head out to Cooker. So let's join together in worship and then we'll head out to Cooker.
Let your light shine, let it be seen, let everybody see your love. Let your light shine, let it be seen, to the praise of the mighty God above. When you're feeling happy, when you're feeling sad, when things go well and when things go bad, let your light shine.
Oh, good morning. Thank you, Barry. Good morning. Our primary story for this week is from the Gospel of John again, and it's going to be the story of the man who was born blind and how he was healed. It's a complicated story. There are lots of different stages in this healing. And while the painting has, while the story has been painted many times throughout Christian history, it raises very interesting questions about which moment in the story you would paint. So you might like to think about that as we look at our works of art for this morning. The first one comes to us from the early part of the 17th century by Annibale Carracci, an Italian painter. He was from Bologna. He needed some help to complete this painting because he took unwell. In fact, I think he may have died just before it was completed, so he wasn't able to complete it. He had assistance. And what you see in this particular painting, of course, is that there's a crowd there, and some members of the crowd look like they're taken aback by the astonishing events. You also see Jesus himself. He is leaning forward and he is touching the eye, whereas the man, the blind man, is on his knees and his hands are in a, like a kind of prayer position. It's almost as if the artist has brought two parts of the story together, because right at the end of the John story, the man declares Jesus to be the Lord and worships him. So you've got that kind of worshiping gesture. It's as if two parts of the story have been woven into one. The second one is by El Greco. The name means he was the Greek. And it was painted in the mid to late 16th century, probably painted while he was in Venice. And the reason why we say that is that he painted this particular scene many times over, and sometimes with a bit of difference. For instance, in one particular version of this painting, he painted the blind man's mother and father, but they were right at the back of the painting, and he put the face of the patrons who had sponsored the work of art, that particular version, upon it. This one is basically from his Venice period, and you can tell that because he made use of very bright blues and reds during that time, and he's also included some classical kind of Venetian buildings in the background. The third one is from the Danish artist Carl Bloch. He was the man I referred to last week, whose parents wanted him to join the Navy, but he rebelled and became an artist instead. And he painted many scenes, religious scenes. For some galleries, especially more Mormon-like galleries in the States, they've confused this painting with its title, and they think it's all about to do with the story of Bartimaeus when Jesus is entering Jericho on the way to Jerusalem. But it's not. It's actually the healing of the man born blind. But what is rather significant about this, I think, is the crowd is at a greater distance, but also Jesus is at a bit more of a distance from the blind man as well. There's more of a gap there. Now, when I began speaking a moment ago, I said, what would you paint when it came to this particular story that we're reflecting on this morning? Well, we've had crowds here, we've had the moment of healing. The more recent paintings are quite different from the classical works of art. They're more like one-on-one. And so we have this one from Andrei Mironov, an up-and-coming Russian artist, and what you have is the concentration simply on Jesus and the blind man. And as I said in the earlier service this morning, this came home to me because after the 9:30 service a couple of weeks ago, as I was taking off the microphone and having to deal with my hearing aids, my glasses fell off and I stood on them. So I have been to see HCF Eye Care recently, and the person getting me my new glasses kept on saying, look up to the right, look up to the left. And it looks a bit like that, doesn't it? As if Jesus is asking the blind man, now just look up a bit more. The other painting is by Gijs Frieling, who's a Dutch Lutheran. And this is a very modern painting whereby the blind man is dressed in a kind of pullover-like top, which we would see today. It's got love hearts on it, which I guess is an expression of the compassion and love of Christ. But what you have is the moment when Jesus is putting the mud onto the eyes of the blind man. You can't see any crowd, you just see, you can't really see much of Jesus either. It's basically the man's face. And overriding this is also the biblical story of how can I not notice the speck in my own eye as I look at the log in someone else's. So bringing two themes together. I have a poem for you today, and it's not Andrew Nuttall, because I found a better one after that, by an American poet called Charles Streitelmeyer. It's called Mud in Your Eye. Spit in the face, dust on the head, we dread such tokens of disgrace in our mortality. But when love blends the two, the clay in your hands is why we live. Mud in the eye is how we see. Now, I think we have changed the order of service, so a song we would have sung now will come after the reflection. So, Barbara, I need you now. No, sorry, I don't need you now. I need you in a moment. We need to have the readings first of all. So we've got three people to do the readings because it's one of those complex readings from John's Gospel.
Our reading today is from John 9, verses 1 to 41. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered,
"Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world."
When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him,
"Go wash in the pool of Siloam,"
which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbours and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying,
"I am the man."
But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered,
"The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight."
They said to him, "Where is he?" He said,
"I do not know."
They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day. When Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes, then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them,
"He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see."
Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said,
"He is a prophet."
The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son, who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age, he will speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." So for the second time they called the man who had been blind and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered,
"I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, though, I was blind, now I see."
They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them,
"I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear again? Do you also want to become his disciples?"
Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered,
"Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing."
They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said,
"Do you believe in the Son of Man?"
He answered,
"And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him."
Jesus said to him,
"You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he."
He said,
"Lord, I believe."
And he worshipped him.
Jesus
said,
"I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind."
Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them,
"If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains."
Hear the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. May the words of our mouths and the thoughts of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Well, Barbara, how good your eyesight?
Not too bad. I can see you, tall, dark and handsome, with thick wavy hair.
I like what you see. I'm all in favour of people with imagination and those who indulge in a little bit of artistic licence.
Glad to oblige.
Speaking of artistic licence, what did you see in those paintings this morning?
The ones to do with Jesus healing the man born blind, that's some story, so many twists and turns. What do you focus upon? I'm no artist myself, but I'm not sure I would know which part of the episode I would choose to paint.
You're quite right. It's a very complicated story. It's one of those encounters that we find in the Book of Signs, the first 11 chapters in the Gospel of John.
I'll come to the paintings in a moment, but let me digress first.
Please do. I'm not surprised.
It seems to me that this gospel writer is rather different to the other three.
You've hit the nail on the head there.
And it seems that his gospel is like a work of art as well.
Go on.
It seems as if he, and I presume it's a he.
I would think so.
It would seem as if he is bringing a number of episodes, a number of encounters in Jesus' ministry.
Like the wedding at Cana, Nicodemus, the woman at the well.
And now the blind man, to illustrate a message. And that message has to do with who Jesus is.
You're on the right track, Barbara. Each one of them is on what we might call a journey of discovery. There are all these I am sayings running through John.
Just like here, before he even begins to heal the man born blind, Jesus says, I am the light of the world.
And the various incidents make use of imagery, symbolism, double meanings, events and controversies, conversations among a host of characters to draw out a response to who Jesus is and to bear witness.
Because if memory serves me right, and my memory isn't quite what it used to be, because the Gospel of John is like a gigantic court case.
Which twists and turns on who we think Jesus is. Quite right. Now we've done with that distraction, that digression. Those paintings, what did you see? What stood out for you? What caught your eye?
Well, let me say first of all that I would prefer to be standing in front of the paintings instead of squinting at them on my computer screen. But since you asked, the first one caught my eye as it had so much emotion showing in the faces of all around Jesus. They are people, neighbors, I guess, in shock, looking intently, looking away. The next two were very colorful. The fourth one caught my eye the most, as it was realistic and intimate. It seemed a more private event between Christ and the pauper, and could be any of us, really.
And the last one?
The most confronting, with all that brown mud.
And the blind man clothed in the way, I nearly said, the fashion of today.
And you, what did you see?
I think it has more to do with what I did not see. It seems to me that the artists in these works have chosen their moment. Each one of them has depicted the moment of Jesus actually healing the man born blind.
That's what really dominant in the last two, where there are no figures, no crowds, no neighbors, no Pharisees.
In the first three, Jesus' hand stretched out to the man kneeling before him.
The healing touch.
And is that a hint of the man on the way to worshipping and believing that Jesus is the light of the world?
I hadn't thought of that.
And the surrounding crowd of people, a public rather than a private event.
You've just spoken about what's there, but a moment ago you were talking about what's not there.
That's right. I found myself first thinking about the moment before the man is healed, before he encounters Jesus, blind from birth. How would an artist capture that? The story that unfolds presupposes a life in darkness and shadows up until this moment.
The text refers to the man being a beggar. It refers to his parents. Are they in any of the paintings? I don't know.
And I don't suppose that question was asked, who sinned? Was it this man or his parents? I don't think it came out of nowhere.
Imagine a life led being surrounded by suspicion all the time, not just at this moment, but always.
And likewise for his parents. We can move so quickly in our reading of him recovering his sight. I found myself wanting to linger a bit on his blindness and his life without sight. It made me think of an Australian theologian, Jonathan Hull.
Never heard of him.
He lectured on Christian education in Birmingham in England and wrote a couple of rather revealing books. The first was on what prevents Christian adults from learning.
And the second?
It's called Touching the Rock.
Tell me more.
Okay. Jonathan Hull was born with sight. Gradually, during his teenage and adolescent years, his sight began to deteriorate, and eventually, at the age of 45, he became fully blind. He describes what that process was like. What was it like then to rely on the memory of what things looked like?
what people he knew looked like.
He said that even as he aged, they remained the same. In his line of sight, they never grew older.
I suppose he had to think about what it was like to rely much more upon his other remaining senses.
And in particular, hearing. To begin with, it was very important what voices sounded like. He would speak about the character of a person's voice. And then he spoke about how much he liked it when it rained. He could hear the rain beating on different surfaces, and then could imagine the leaves of the trees, the hard surfaces of concrete and asphalt, and so on.
This is the very opposite of the story in John's Gospel. This fellow is not healed.
That's right, but there's more. In a variation of whose sins, he found himself on the receiving end of those earnest Christians who wished to pray for his healing, his recovery of sight.
If only he would pray just a little bit harder. If only he had a little more, bit more faith. Faith enough to move mountains.
That's right. He became fair game for such folk. He was at their mercy. They had power over him because they could see. They were his equivalents of the neighbors in the story.
And so what happened?
He distanced himself from them, and he came to a fresh insight. Over time, though now blind, he came to see things differently, and he would describe his going blind as a terrible gift. A terrible gift that he would not wish upon anybody else.
But a gift? What do you mean? What did he mean by a gift?
Amazing grace. He began to see things, to notice things he hadn't seen or known before. A bit like, though he didn't make the comparison himself, to John Newton.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
Did you notice that one of the lines in the story in the Gospel of John, the man says, "Once I was blind, but now I see." Except in the case of John Newton, the composer of Amazing Grace, he had likewise gone blind after a life of seeing. And he had come to realize that in the years of his full sight, he had been blind to the suffering of others, and in particular to the suffering of slaves in the transatlantic slave trade.
I once was blind, but now I see.
And so Newton, along with the likes of William Wilberforce, were at the leading edge of those who campaigned for the abolition of the slave trade.
That's the background of Amazing Grace and all those singers and pipe band versions.
They had to stand up, to speak out, be true to what they knew. Newton had undergone a religious conversion. He needed to speak truth to power of layer after layer of vested interests of the power because of what they knew, because of what they now saw.
The Gospel of John is about a beggar, a pauper who is blind from birth. Just looking at the text again, I can't see any slaves or slave traders, bankers and corporations that have benefited from such in this episode of Jesus and the Blind Man.
Which brings me back to what is missing in the works of art. In the ones that were on the screen, Jesus was always present. His hand was stretched out, mixing saliva with mud, touching the man's eyes. But in John's account, Jesus is absent for a good part of the time.
The man goes to the pool to wash his eyes. His neighbors want to know why he can now see. Is he the same person as the blind man they knew as the beggar? They drag him off to the Pharisees. He becomes the pawn in their conversation about who it was that healed him. His parents get dragged into proceedings. He can't rely on them, though, because they're afraid. They say, "Ask him. He's old enough to speak for himself." It is as if they don't wish to become involved in these power plays.
But the man does not know who has healed him. He has not yet seen Jesus now that his sight is restored. He does not know where the man who has healed him has gone. That is, until Jesus, having heard that the man has been driven out for saying what was right, Jesus then comes to find the man.
And the account moves on through to his confession that Jesus is Lord. And the Pharisees are left puzzled by the suggestion that they might be blind.
I was struck by the integrity of the man born blind. He didn't wilt under pressure. He faced with those who appear to have a lot of authority, a lot of power.
A lot of confidence.
It's very easy in such situations to cave in and deny what has happened, to deny the one who has helped you.
In a way, we might say this man born blind is a bit like a whistleblower. He speaks truth to power.
As did Jonathan Hull about his blindness, as did John Newton about the slave trade, and as we seek to do every time we sing Amazing Grace. It's so easy not to see what is there before us. It is so easy for all the rumours and suspicions, the contrary voices, the shadow of fear to insinuate and then overpower us. But the man born blind can't pretend that Jesus has not touched him
and restored his sight,
despite all the pressures around him to be less than true to what he knows.
Our works of art did not capture the whole story. I don't suppose they can. There's so much going on in this story from John's Gospel.
It left me thinking about a hymn by Ross Langmead from Melbourne. Sometimes music, sometimes the lyrics of what we sing can sound an echo deep within, maybe a trigger or way of seeing. Will you join me, Barbara?
You mean sing a duet?
A solo, if you prefer.
No, thank you.
No. Will you read with me, Lord, let me see? Lord, let me see more and more. See the beauty of a person, not the colour of the skin. See the faces of the homeless,
with no one to take them in. See discouragement, because she'll never win. See the faces of our Lord in the pain.
Let me see. Lord, let me hear more and more. Hear the sounds of great rejoicing, hear a person barely sigh, hear the ring of truth
and hollowness of those who live a lie. Hear the wail of starving people who will die. Hear the voice of our Lord in the cry.
Lord, let me hear.
Lord, let me care more and more. Care for those who feel the loneliness, for those who have no say. Care for friends who have no job
and find it hard to face the day. Care for those with whom we sing and work and pray, and in care Jesus Christ will be found.
Lord, let me care.
Lord, let me learn more and more. Learn that what I know is just a speck of what there is to know. Learn from listening to my
neighbor when I'd rather speak and go. Learn that as we live in faith and trust, we grow. Learn to see, hear, and care with our Lord.
Lord, let me learn. Lord, let me love more and more. Love the loveless and the fragile. Help them be what they can be. Love the way that I would like them
to be looking after me. For to know you is to love them and be free. And in love, Jesus Christ will be found, Lord.
Let me love.
Lord, let me see.
Oh, now sing Amazing Grace. My chains are gone.
Amazing grace, how sweet.
Let's pray our prayers for others. And at the end of our prayers, please join me with the Lord's Prayer that will be on the big screen. Let's pray. Gracious and loving Lord, we are grateful for this new day when we can gather to acknowledge your presence with us and to be thankful for those surprising moments of grace that come as we live in your presence, in your world. We thank you this morning for all the glimpses of gentleness and generosity in the world, shown by people who care, in places of violence, of oppression, or injustice especially. In Syria and Ukraine, where the continuing conflict, violence and destruction have brought so much grief to people who have lost so much, we believe your enduring sadness hovers over that place as we remember and pray for those who work toward the possibilities of an end to this violence and a much longed for peace settlement. So many severe global weather events become part of our news reports now, and we are so often blind to the effects of our inaction on climate change, particularly in places where poor people pay the price. We give thanks for all the people who have risked their lives to rescue others in southeast Turkey and in Malawi. In Turkey, where severe flooding has occurred in areas already devastated by earthquakes, where people whose homes were already lost to them in an earthquake have been swept away in their temporary container homes. And in Malawi, one of the world's poorest nations, where a tropical cyclone has caused landslides and huge devastation, we pray that events such as these will highlight new ways for us all to bring faster help in crisis situations. The Lifeline report has told us that there has been a huge increase in calls for help in the wake of rent increases and interest rate hikes. We thank you for the ways your spirit moves through counsellors and others, so that people in great need can hear new ways to survive a really difficult time. There are people we can name among our church community and among our friends and family, people who are in trauma, in sickness, or in special need. We pray your blessing on them now. As we remember them before you in a moment of silence. The story of the man blind from birth opens so much for us. For all those, Lord, who stand against misguided public opinion and have been vilified, condemned, and even jailed, we pray. And in our own lives, may we be slow to judge and faster to listen and show mercy. In his lifetime, Jesus showed us all the ways. Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The offering will now be received. Let us pray. You come to us through the ebb and flow of life. You come to us in Christ Jesus, the light of the world, seeking to overcome the limitations of what we see and what we hear. And now we bring to you our gifts, our tokens, signs and symbols of how your words and your deeds, the offering of Christ himself, has touched us, led us, lays claim to us. We pray that these gifts may be used for the well-being of our world, through opening our eyes and ears to the way of wisdom, justice, mercy, and compassion. Amen. Just some brief notices first. Margaret Leckie, who was a member of this congregation of the 8 o'clock service she used to attend. She died about 7 to 10 days ago. Her funeral is on Thursday of this week at 2 p.m. It will be held at the at Castlewood. It's not here in the church, it's at Castlewood at 2 p.m. Secondly, the study, our Lenten study continues this evening at 6:45 for the continuation of week two. And if you're interested, and if the 8 o'clock congregation hasn't taken them all, there are some handouts if you're interested in the foyer. Next week, we'll be looking at the way in which Matthew talks about how Jesus was on the cross, and I'll speak a little bit about what crucifixion meant in the ancient world. Also, after the service, there was a congregational meeting, but before then, Judy Mann, who usually goes to the 8 o'clock service, will speak to us about how we welcome newcomers.
Good morning, good morning, everybody, and thank you, Barbara, as well, and Sandra, thank you. Now, my name's Judy Mann, and I came to St. Matthew's last June, about 8 months ago. And this is our service representative, service rep, Sandra Drayton, if you'd like to come here, please. And Sandra is the service rep for this 9:30 service. So I came along to St. Matthew's to check it out and see if it was the right church for me. And it was. And I now consider this community and the whole fellowship to be my new church home. And what helped me decide to stay here was the very warm welcome at the door when I first walked in. But what helped me to stay was getting involved in all sorts of church activities. And now what's keeping me here is a sense of belonging to this community. Now, some of you can remember coming along here for the very first time. And I think some others might have actually been baptized into this church. And I do know for sure that some of you have been here since the church began 50 plus years ago. So Sandra, what was your welcome to St. Matthew's like when you first came here?
Two quick things. One is that I didn't come alone. And I think maybe for people who come singly or on their own on the day, it can be much more difficult. We're a twosome, so people noticed us perhaps more. So perhaps we need to keep that in mind when we're watching for newcomers. But the second thing is that we were asked, did we have a doctor? Did we have a dentist? Because we were new to the area. That was the sort of thing that really impressed us. We loved that. Lots more, but they're the things I remember on that first couple of weeks.
So thanks a lot, Sandra. And like Sandra and myself, we've all got our stories about being a newcomer here at St Matthew's. Now, newcomers are actually very important. We want to welcome them, and we want them to really feel included and supported and appreciated and acknowledged. But since COVID and the various lockdowns, we've not returned to our once very effective systems for looking after all of our newcomers. And I think it's time for us to take a look at how we manage our newcomers, our welcome to newcomers, so that they stay and that they can grow in St Matthew's. So Clive's asked me to have a look at establishing a policy that welcomes all of our newcomers across the whole church and putting in place some practical steps to ensure that all newcomers can feel that they can settle in here quickly and happily. And the elders have agreed to this. So what's actually happening? It's a small group representing the three services, and we're going to look at our current practices, and we're going to keep all the good practices. And we already have some of those, and some of us are familiar with those. But we are going to add some new ideas. So we all have and understand a streamlined, right across the church, coordinated policy and approach to managing our newcomers. So, how can you help? First of all, we want to get a really good idea about your thinking around newcomers. I'd like you to tell us about your own personal experience when you were first a newcomer here at St Matthew's. So you could ring me, or you could send me a text or an email, or just write a note and leave it with your service rep or in the office. And details about who I am is in this week's newsletter. Then secondly, if you think that this interests you and you'd like to help a little more working closely with newcomers, you might let me know and your service rep know, and then we can see what we can do to really build a community right across the church that everyone feels so welcomed and appreciated. Thanks a lot, Clive. And thank you, Sandra.
I was interested that Sandra and Dean were welcomed with asking about dentists and doctors. Following the 8 a.m. service this morning on the theme of the man born blind, I had so many discussions about eyesight and surgery. We belong to Christ in a world that is often distracted, in a world that is full of noise and competing claims. Let us be a people who seek to be a people with eyes to see, ears to hear, hearts to understand the ways of peace, justice, forgiveness, and amazing grace. Amen. We stand for our final song.
See ya.
May the word of God resound within you. May the light of Christ go before you and light up your pathway. And may the Spirit of God, which blows where it wills, be your source of comfort and joy. Go now in the name of the three in one God. Amen. Thank you.